A fuel crisis in one of the world's richest nations. Petrol pumps in the UK are running dry because there aren't enough truck drivers to deliver the fuel. Is Brexit to blame? And has this exposed deeper problems within the haulage industry? This is Inside Story. Hello and welcome to the programme. I'm Imran Khan. It's not something you see every day in the UK. Drivers waiting hours in long queues to fill their cars at the petrol station. The government says panic buying is partly to blame for the pumps running dry. Fuel companies say there's no shortage of petrol, just a lack of tanker drivers to deliver supplies. The government has placed soldiers on standby to help, and it's granting temporary work visas to 5,000 truck drivers. But industry leaders say the measures aren't enough to solve the crisis. Andrew Simmons reports from London.
A new working week, and this isn't the normal London morning gridlock. The fuel station here ran dry 2 days ago. It's been waiting for this moment. Tanker drivers are in short supply, not the fuel. Whatever, the result's the same. Misery for some, not panic buying. Ada Babatovci ran out of fuel 100 metres from the petrol pumps after a search that started in the early hours.
And I was very emotional, so I cried. I cried with all this. It's absolutely unnecessary. I cried and I feel so emotional. I think probably a lot of people were going through a similar way.
Lives disrupted. This driving instructor trying to get fuel to prepare his learners for their driving tests.
I've got about 5-6 tests coming up between now and next week. So I was really and truly terrified what might happen for this guy's test. So I've been going around like headless chicken around London. Nothing.
An opinion poll suggests that more than 60% of voters feel the government is mishandling the situation. And some of the messaging from ministers isn't helping the public mood.
The only reason that we have an issue at the moment with some petrol stations not having petrol in the forecourts is that people are buying petrol and they wouldn't. The most important thing everyone can do is just get back to normal, fill their cars up as they normally would, and not buy petrol unless they need it.
It would seem to be wishful thinking that this crisis is going to go away without government action. Crisis? What crisis has been the government's stance up to now? Now it's changing because people don't like being referred to as panic buyers in a situation such as this. There is a tide of public dissent. And so the pressure is on the government as the tension on the forecourts increases. Some companies have introduced rationing. Competition measures have been stopped so that fuel companies can cooperate on logistics. Another move the government has made is to try backing up UK tanker drivers with foreigners no longer able to work here because of Brexit. Short-term visas are available for 5,000 foreign truck drivers. It isn't guaranteed to work. Andrew Simmons, Al Jazeera, London.
And the lack of truck drivers is contributing to the UK's worst shortage of basic goods since the 1970s. From building materials to medical supplies and groceries, many items are in short supply. Supermarkets are warning of empty shelves ahead of Christmas. The pandemic and Britain's departure from the EU have also disrupted supply chains. Now, the shortage of truck drivers is a problem across Europe as well. Transport analysts say Poland was short of more than 120,000 drivers last year. Germany needed another 60,000. The industry has been struggling to attract new workers as many leave for jobs with better pay and working conditions. Since the start of the pandemic, the industry has faced more pressure to deliver essential goods. The huge growth of online shopping has also had an impact. Let's bring in our guests in Edinburgh, Dougie Rankin, a lorry driver and the editor of Truck and Driver magazine. In London, Vicky Price, chief economic advisor at the Centre for Economics and Business Research. And in Liverpool, Temidaya Akinroy, senior lecturer in procurement and supply chain management at Liverpool John Moores University. Welcome to the programme. Let's begin in Edinburgh first with Dougie Rankin. The government says this is panic buying. The haulage industry says, actually, this is a lack of drivers due to Brexit. What's the truth of it?
Lack of drivers due to Brexit would grossly oversimplify the situation. If we're talking about the fuel crisis at the moment, That seems to be the public has collectively gone off on one. It's not really affecting Scotland, curiously, I've noticed. Tanker drivers have to have certification for ADR to deliver dangerous goods such as petrol and diesel. And I don't understand where a huge number of them have suddenly disappeared to one week to the next. This was originally a problem associated to BP, and it had nothing to do with the rest of the sort of tanker industry and the supply of fuel. So something's got very blown out of proportion in the press and the media with what's going on, because there isn't a shortage of fuel. It's now difficult to keep the fuel stations replenished, and people seem to be continually panic buying. The message isn't getting out there to tell them not to do it. So it's very strange and unusual times right now, as the drivers, because the driver shortage situation does keep evolving from one week to the next.
But what is the reason behind that driver shortage? I still don't really understand. Is it a lack of drivers? Is it simply because drivers from the EU just don't want to come to the UK anymore? Because why would they? There's too much paperwork.
Well, Brexit isn't a major factor in the driver shortage. It's played a part in it, but there's a huge number of different factors which have all come to play at the same time. There was the tax change, IR35, which made it a lot more difficult for drivers to operate on a self-employed basis, and it made it a lot less attractive. So we lost drivers through that. There was the driver CPC deadline in 2019, which lost a lot of older drivers to the industry, because lorry drivers need to do 35 hours training periodically every 5 years to keep their licence. And a lot of guys kind of just decided that they weren't going to bother, and coronavirus and the lockdown certainly put paid to that. So we lost a lot of old drivers who maybe wouldn't be full-time, but would take up a lot of the slack. They would do odd shifts here and there. And there's also, last year, the DVLA and the DVSA downed tools very quickly on the onset of the pandemic, and we had no new drivers coming through last year at all. Nobody was passing driver's tests. So there's a lot of different factors in there. You could also say that there's people, if you want to become a lorry driver, it's very expensive. So people who want to can't do it, and there isn't enough support out there. And also the industry has an image problem whereby there aren't enough people wanting to become lorry drivers either. There were over 300 test spots for vocational driving tests not taken up with the DVLA last week, and there were hundreds before that. And the government's kind of created this, saying that they're needing to release extra capacity by using the Ministry of Defence, but there aren't enough people wanting to take the tests at the moment, or aren't able to. So that's quite a curious one from our side. I'd like to know a little bit more about that, but just to pin everything on one simple factor, it's not, it's hugely complicated with multiple things all going on at the same time.
A perfect storm, if you will. Vicky Price in London, you're an economic advisor. What do you think of the advice coming out from the British government? We're going to have 5,000 temporary visas. That's going to magically sort out the problem, surely.
What we seem to have is a shortage of about 100,000 lorry drivers for all the reasons that have just been explained, but Brexit has played a part as well. And it's interesting, if you talk to the retailers who have been, you know, shouting about this for quite some time, and if you talk to the general distribution companies as well, which are suffering right now from shortage of people prepared to drive the trucks that should really be moving things around, Brexit is actually being blamed quite a lot. And the worries are that the reaction from the government so far has been a bit slow and very bitty. In other words, you know, if you have 100,000 vacancies and you bring in 5,000 in with some special licenses and hope that they will do the job for 3 months and then go back because they're meant to be temporary too, the problem simply isn't going to be solved. So it is an issue. Plus, of course, the way in which trade is happening across. What you find is that not very many foreign lorry drivers want to come in, or even, you know, businesses want to engage because they can't do what they did before in the UK. They don't have the freedom to move around and pick things and move them somewhere else, which means that you've had that shortage there too, the unwillingness for, you know, people to take on a load and bring it over to the UK, which then deprives you, of course, of workers who might be able to drive other trucks or even their own truck and take things around because of the change in the cabotage rules. You can't do that very easily any longer because we're outside the EU.
Temudaya, I'm just going to come to you in just a moment, but I want to bring in Dougie Rankin here. One of the interesting things about this is this temporary visa situation. They're going to issue 5,000 temporary truck driver licenses. They're going to last 3 months. But I was on a couple of Romanian chat platforms where they were reacting to this, this particularly in Romania, where they were like, why would we bother? Why would we go for just 3 months? I've got a good job here. I'm not going to give it up just to go and help the Brits out.
Yeah, it is. Well, the haulage, the Road Haulage Association has been asking for a long time to say, you know, we need visas. We need to get labour in from Europe. We need to get people in. But we've been asking the question over and over again, who is wanting to come here? Where is this long line of drivers who are prepared to come over to the UK? And how is this going to work? I mean, how on earth are we going to get people who are going to leave their job in, say, for example, Romania, and come here for 3 months? And then what happens? They've got to go home again? Do they have a job to go back to in Romania? Because perhaps their employer there isn't going to look very favourably on them for just upping sticks. Where are they going to live? It doesn't make any sense at all, the short-term visa fix. It's bizarre. If they want to go and look to get drivers in from other countries, I don't think you've got to look beyond Europe, and it needs to be, it's not, you're not going to get a quick fix out either. You're probably looking at Asia, and you're probably looking at Africa to get drivers to who will want to emigrate to come here and live here permanently. I don't think there's a great desire from Europe to come here. It's as simple as that. And this visa thing.
Well, I want to put that, Dougie. I want to put that thought to Temudaya Akinroy. Temudaya, you've got a fascinating job title, Procurement and Supply Chain Management. Now, as I understand it, supply chain management, as it currently stands, means everything is done quite last minute. You bring in your goods, you take them to, say, I don't know, the Midlands, and then you get another truck and you drive that full of goods from the Midlands into Europe. But Brexit has put paid to that. The supply chain was always last minute, and Brexit doesn't allow for that. Is that right?
Yes, I think these factors are interconnected in one way or the other. The supply chain within the country is linked also to availability of facilitators of the supply chain. So logistics, transportation facilitates the goods, movements of goods and services within a country. And these are linked to different last mile delivery. So for instance, some of the shortages in truck drivers, you know, it's not causing fuel shortages. People are just reacting to the news, and that's what's causing the panic buying. So a lot of fuel station or supermarkets have delays in delivery of their goods and services, and the population feel, you know, we don't know when this is going to stop. We don't know whether this will continue. The ripple effect could also be felt in other sectors of the economy. So this is not just one factor. We need to look at it from a systemic point of view. There are different factors playing out here, and the supply chain cannot be exempted from it.
Vicky Price, one of the reasons, one of the things that makes the supply chain work is this idea that immigration actually does work in certain sectors of the British economy. I'm the son of immigrants. My father is incredibly suspicious. He came from Pakistan to the UK because he was asked to do so by the British government back then because there were a certain amount of jobs that the British people just didn't want to do. There was the Windrush generation of black British people from the Caribbean who came over. Some of those have now been deported back to Jamaica. There's a mistrust here of the British government's actual promise on whether they'll deliver on these visas and this idea of immigration making things work. So that's putting people off from coming here and working. It's also mixed messaging that's going on. You're an economic advisor. I mean, are you shaking your head at the way the messaging is coming out from the Brits?
Yes, a little bit. I have to say communication hasn't been at its best. But the interesting thing is, if you look at the evidence, migration has been a great contributory factor to the growth of the UK economy. And of course, joining the EU has also been beneficial from that point of view, because businesses have been able to expand without worrying too much about where they'd get the labour from. And of course, yes, in some areas, perhaps wages were kept slightly lower than they otherwise should have been, but not in very many. In fact, the evidence suggests that overall, this hasn't happened across the economy, but it has helped companies respond to the demand. And it's also, of course, helped grow the economy more generally and therefore create more jobs. So we had very low unemployment, as despite the fact there were so many immigrants coming in and working, and many of them becoming permanent from the EU. And that now, the fact that we've left, is giving a bit of a shock to the economy, to which we haven't quite adapted. And the messaging, therefore, is really quite important. I mean, people are not really against immigration as such. They've realised we need them in so many areas, such as, you know, right now the care sector is screaming for more labour as well. So it isn't just the lorry drivers, who generally get paid a lot more than people who work in the care sector, but it seems to have been spreading across, including the construction sector. So it's not good for the economy in the short term. And what the OECD has said, the Organisation for Economic Cooperation and Development, that has been looking at inflation expectations in various countries, it has highlighted the UK as one country which is going to see more of a push in terms of inflation because of those supply chain constraints that you were just discussing earlier, which are going to be much tougher in the UK than perhaps in other places, which are also having some of those issues, but not to the extent that we're experiencing them here.
Dougie Rankin, the British tabloids are having a field day with this. I keep reading headlines that suggest that truck drivers are now being offered signing on bonuses of like £2,000. There's wages of like 70,000, 66,000 to £70,000 a year for a truck driver. How much of that is true and how much of that is actually going to work? Like, can you bribe people into becoming truck drivers quickly?
I think a lot of those huge wage figures are absolute nonsense. That's not what I'm hearing from drivers I speak to on the ground level. There's a lot of suspicious sort of figures that were bandied about by very large companies. And yeah, they're doing sort of £1,000, £2,000 golden handshakes, these big firms. But what you can also find in a lot of places is that they're not good companies to work for. And in many cases, there's a lot of undesirable, unpleasant lorry driving jobs, which companies are struggling to get people to do. And yeah, they're putting these big wage figures about, but that's not the whole part of it. The sort of conditions that drivers have got to put up with are pretty terrible. There's been nothing said from the government at all about improving parking facilities for drivers, because it's difficult for some of them to get safe places to park at night and rest. And the money thing, I'm very suspicious of. I don't believe that those figures will translate into sort of real world.
Just quickly, Dougie.
End up getting that.
Just quickly, Dougie. How long does it actually? So, say if I wanted to become a truck driver in the UK now, how long before I make that decision to actually getting in a truck and driving? Like, how long does that take?
Well, it depends how quickly the DVLA are processing your licence at the moment, because they are also culpable in that they've been very slow getting licences back to people. I know someone at the moment who had an accident and lost their licence due to a medical issue, and they're now fit and well, and they've been passed and ready to go, and they've been waiting months and months for the DVLA to get them their licence back. But if you want to be a truck driver, there are several steps you need to jump through. They are trying to fast track people through so you can go straight from driving a car to an articulated lorry. But it is still, there are still several steps you've got to go through. You've got to get a medical. You've got to go and do a theory test, a hazard perception test. You've got to do your driving.
Right.
And they're in the process of changing that, so you don't need to do a reversing manoeuvre. But you can't just go and do it and then 2 weeks later you're out driving, not even close. It's quite a convoluted process.
OK. Timmy Dio in Liverpool is throwing money and shortcuts, as Dougie was saying, shortcuts into in the exam test, a solution to this problem? Because that's what the government seems to be doing.
Unfortunately, no. It's just a momentary, incentive, you know, calling people that you come and get more money and then you become a truck driver. And I think some of the hurdles of becoming a truck driver within 24 hours or within 2 weeks has been said. There are a lot of processes you have to go through, but I think what is important now is for the different stakeholders in the logistics and transport sector to be speaking together, to be working together and speaking to each other. At the moment, you hear different response from the government. DVLA is, you know, trying to put together a fast track process for you to become a truck driver. We can't work in silos, so we need all the stakeholders, including professional bodies, the Institute of Logistics and Transport. They need to work together and find a solution to this. But may I add to this as well, that the working condition of the driver is another critical factor that makes the job, you know, unattractive for even young people in England. A lot of the truck drivers, they eat and sleep over in their truck, they don't rest. So there is need for improved working condition for them. And the government needs to intervene here to bring out new employment policies that are targeted to addressing some of these challenges that the workers are facing.
Vicky Price in London, to make a terrible pun, but you could see this truck coming a mile off, couldn't you? You knew that once you'd left Brexit, you were going to have problems in supply chain, in getting goods into the UK, because borders had changed.
Absolutely. And of course, what the government here is doing is they've realised that if they put any extra pressures, of course, on any imports coming in and therefore, you know, trucks that come in fully loaded, that would also make things considerably worse in terms of getting goods to where they should be going. And we have, in fact, waived the right that we've had to impose those restrictions to next year now. So already there's been a delay in that a number of times this year. So it's understood that it's an issue. Although we've done that in terms of imports, we don't seem to have really acted at all fast in dealing with the added problems of the supply chain that have been affected so substantially by all the shortages that we have been discussing today. So yes, this truck was coming and we should have edged out of the way or at least done something to slow the speed. But for the moment, I'm afraid we look like we are fighting one panic after another and not fantastically well. There are people who think that it's just transitory issues and they will all be solved. But it looks to me and to any economist who's seen that as you know, pretty negative in terms of what it might mean for growth, even in the short term. We've seen GDP here already slowing down. This bounce back we've had since the opening up has slowed down very significantly. And I'm suspecting that when we get the data for September, it's not going to be particularly good either because of all the shortages and also the price increases we're seeing at present.
Dougie Rankin, our guest in London, Vicky Price, has said a lot of people think this is transitory and it's going to be solved. But do you think that a lot of people are going to have a miserable Christmas because this is not going to finish in the next 3 months? This is going to take a while.
I don't see why people necessarily need to have a miserable Christmas unless the media, certain sections of it, if they're determined to agitate the public enough to make sure that we do, then perhaps that we will, because if they want to start panicking people now, so they're already away going, buying out frozen turkeys before the Halloween stuff's even off the shelves, then it could happen. But it's not a transitory thing. There needs to be kind of some fundamental changes in the way that road transport operates in the UK. The industry's got to get people in to drive these trucks. There's a terrible image problem in the industry. And there's also a wider problem in the UK of getting people to be interested in vocational qualifications as well. Because you can't get, it's a struggle for people, companies to get people to want to be truck mechanics and tradesmen in general. That's something that's a struggle as well as getting drivers. And to get people to, how do we make the haulage industry more attractive? How do we get people to say, yes, I think that I want to drive a truck? Because even with these large figures of money getting banded about, people still don't seem to want to do it. For an awful long time, lorries have been like seen as dirty, smelly things, or a nuisance that get in your way when you're wanting to go to work and things. And the industry has got a big problem in improving the image and also the conditions as well, which goes back to the government, because I think there's a lot that it needs to do to force through better parking facilities and force supermarkets to treat drivers better, because I could go off in a whole separate area there about the way...
Unfortunately, Dougie, we are running out of time.
Distribution centres.
We are running out of time. It's a fascinating discussion. And one of the things I think is coming out of this is that we need more truck drivers. I want to thank all our guests, Dougie Rankin, Vicky Price and Temudio Akinroy. And I want to thank you too for watching. You can see the programme again anytime by visiting our website, aljazeera.com. And for further discussion, go to our Facebook page. That's facebook.com/AJInsideStory. And you can also join the conversation on Twitter. We are @AJInsideStory. From me, Imran Khan, and the whole team here, bye for now.